And welcome to our masterclass, A Small Business Guide to Staffing and the Skills Shortage. I'm Cec Busby, the editor of Koshy's Business Builders, and I'm delighted to be your host today as we broadcast live from International Towers at Barangaroo in Sydney. Now, today's topic is an important one, especially given the current climate that we find ourselves in. The COVID-19 pandemic has had a significant impact on businesses worldwide, and the shortage of skilled workers is a challenge that businesses of all sizes are facing. Now, don't worry, we're here to help. In this webinar, we'll explore strategies that small businesses can use to attract and retain skilled talent in a highly competitive job market. But before we dive into our session, I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we meet today, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and pay my respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging. I also extend that respect to any Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander people watching today. Now, joining me as co-host for this webinar is someone who really knows the ins and outs of staffing and recruitment, Roxanne Calder. Roxanne is the founder and managing director at Est10, a leading boutique recruitment agency. And with a bachelor's degree from Monash University and an MBA from the Australian Graduate School of Management, Roxanne has worked in recruitment and HR across several countries, including Australia, the UK, Singapore, and Japan. Her passion for helping people secure meaningful employment has led her to write her first book, Employable: 7 Attributes to Assure Your Working Future, and what she doesn't know about recruiting and retaining great staff isn't worth knowing. So we're incredibly fortunate to have her share her insights and strategies on how small businesses can navigate the skills shortage and attract top talent today. Roxanne, welcome.
Thanks for having me, Cec.
It's great to have you here. Now, I read some interesting survey data recently from the AI Group's annual skills survey, and it found that staffing and skills shortages are among the top three issues facing small business owners in 2023. The others were inflation and supply disruption. And it also found that 9 in 10 businesses expect to be affected by staffing shortages in the next 12 months. So it's a very real issue for business owners. So Roxanne, what do you think is causing this staffing crunch?
Well, it's multi-pronged, and I'm not surprised that that was the results of the survey at all, because I see it and feel it every single day, and people think that it's just something that happened post-pandemic or just for 2022, but in actual fact, this is an ongoing issue. It's across the board in terms of what the issues are, and I delve into that actually a little bit here when I do the presentation. I can sort of share a little bit more, but yeah, it is a major issue. It's stopping businesses from expanding, from sort of gaining back traction over the last few years. It's a real issue. It's chronic.
Yeah, so the pandemic was kind of this catalyst that made the issues rise to the surface, but really there has been this staffing and skills shortage for quite some time.
Yeah, so the staff shortage has been happening well before the pandemic. What COVID did was just bring it all to the surface. The things like we talk about in terms of employee rights and power and all those sorts of things, that just came just bubbling straight up to the surface. And that's why we have some of these more issues now.
Yeah, because attracting top talent is getting harder and harder,
really,
isn't
hard.
It?
Yeah, really hard.
Yes, so you have put together a fantastic presentation for us to kind of take our audience through some of these issues that they're facing at the moment. Shall I throw it over to you?
Sure.
And you can get started with that?
Yeah. Thank you, Cec.
Thank you.
So maybe what I did want to say is, yes, I am a recruiter and I know this space really well, but I'm also a small business owner. So I feel the pain and I know exactly what all of these issues are. So today I wanted to give you everything I possibly could to be able to help you in any way, and I've covered a lot of different things here. So first of all, I thought, if anyone has any questions,
yes, any questions,
please shoot them through.
Throw them in the chat box, and Roxanne will take them possibly during or maybe after, depending on
really
the flow of the conversation.
Yeah, happy to do during. You don't wait till the end. So the first thing I wanted to talk to you about is the why. I think it's important to understand why this is happening, because then we can work out the how to navigate. Otherwise, we make the wrong decisions potentially in solving the problem, and then we have a recurring issue. So the first thing to talk about is the fact that our unemployment rate sits at 3.5%. That's a 48-year low, and it's also deemed as full employment. So what that means, Cec, is what you were saying before, for people who are trying to hire, typically you would go to the unemployment pool of people, But instead, we're at full employment, meaning that most people are in a job. So instead, we have to go to the pool of people who are currently working, and that presents the issue. Then we have the aging population exiting the workforce. So our birth rates are below replacement levels, and they sit at currently it's roughly 1.58 versus 3.5 that was in 1961. And then we have, on top of that, in the next 5 years, 500,000 people will be exiting our workforce. So we think about all of these people exiting, and we just don't have the replacement coming through. So first issue, people issue, and then the second issue is the skills piece. So even if you think about your own business, and if you're at full headcount, close to full headcount, I bet you are still having some deficit in skills. And that's because the rate and the pace of the skills that we need, we can't keep up with the development of it and the upskilling and the reskilling that's needed. And yes, small to medium businesses are really the ones that are feeling the pinch greatly. Australian Bureau of Statistics report came out to show that the severity of skills shortage saw 46% of small, 40% of medium businesses with operations impacted to a great extent. And then if I can talk to you briefly about job vacancies, because it's like the supply and the demand situation. So February last year, in that quarter, we saw 423,500 job vacancies, and that was 86% higher than February 2020, and that was just before the pandemic. So you can see we've got this whole issue of all of us trying to hire new people, and then we just don't have the supply coming through. So is the pandemic to blame? It's not. we like to think that it is, but it really isn't. What it has done instead is, as we said, brought all of this to the surface, and there's been a shift and change in what our employees want from their jobs and their careers. So some people want a sabbatical, some people don't want the pressure anymore, some people want a totally different career path. And you know, this is what has brought this all about. And then we talk about the whole jobs that are available. So it's also given power to people to change jobs like that. And it's also a global issue. And in fact, job vacancies in the States have outnumbered applicants and people available to fill the roles since 2018. So we can see that this is just not a pandemic situation.
Yeah, because it's not a job for life anymore, is it? But people are just migrating all over the place to different jobs.
That's really interesting. So for a long while now, the workforce has all been about gaining snippets of experience and moving. But I think that we will start to see some of that loyalty come back. So that's my prediction. It's my hope as well. But you're absolutely right. That's exactly what's been happening in the workforce for a number of years. Mm. So pandemic, not so much. The recession. So if people are thinking this is going to be an equalizer to sort of bottom it out a little bit, please don't count on that. And the reason I say that, in any other times of such economic uncertainty, of global redundancies, then you would be right to think that job security would be number one. But unfortunately, with inflation rates, which is what you mentioned earlier, that's what's causing the issue for people still to be seeking salaries. So real wages shrunk by as much as 3% last year in Australia. The global inflation rate peaked at 8.8 last year, and the International Monetary Fund are forecasting it to be 6.6 for this year. Then if we take into account the global unemployment rate, it's forecasted to reach 5.8 and between 3.7 and 4.5 for Australia. So that whole shift just isn't enough to make it all okay and equalize out. And then again, job vacancies. So they were 92.4% higher than in that February period in 2020. So again, the whole issue of people wanting to hire with new jobs. Okay, so the tips I've got for you today center on retention, where and how to find talent, and the process that you're using. So first of all, for retention, now I've given you 10 here. I'm gonna talk quickly. I could spend so much time on each one, and there are actually more tips, but I just wanted to give you the most and the best ones. So you need to get your fit right. So what I mean by that is be thinking about your business and what it is, the skills that you need, the attitudes that you need, the personality fit that's right, and be recruiting to that. So not everyone is suited to a small business, and like not everyone is suited to a bigger business. And lots of people will say, well, how can I compete with the bigger businesses? I sort of say, don't think like that, because a person that might want to work in a bigger business is probably not going to be the right fit for a smaller business. And smaller businesses have so much to offer. So please be thinking about what's going to work for your environment.
So culture fit is very, very important.
Yeah, totally. So the cultural fit is the piece that will keep people retained and keep people staying with you. And equally with that, if you're hiring at the moment, most people are hiring and putting people in place that are not just one step up, but requiring two or three steps up. What then that means is it's a level of upskilling that is probably going to put people in an uncomfortable zone. So what you then need to think about is, when this falls into sort of the environment as well, is making sure that your environment is a learning environment. So what that means is nurturing, giving patience to people, because the thing is, if people start to feel that they're failing, that will be what will cause people to exit really quickly. So you want to get the fit right, and part of that fit right, if you're upskilling two steps, three steps ahead, is making sure that you're recruiting people with those right attributes. So not everyone can do that. So what that might mean is level of resilience, level of adaptability, abstract learning, all of those things that come into play. So you want to recruit for the job, but then be recruiting for the environment that people are going into.
So can I ask about when you're doing recruiting for a job? Like, we've had a few vacancies recently. That job description, how important is that?
Okay, so with the job description, my advice for people is, if your job description is older than 12 months, then you want to bring that out and review it. In fact, I think everything in your recruitment process probably wants to be reviewed all the time. Mm-hmm. So we review things in my business, we review things every 3 months, because the job description that worked 3 months ago might not be the right fit right now, because everything is moving so quickly. So when you pull that job description out, I often refer to this, that we used to recruit like this maybe 5 years ago, that whole McDonald's analogy of, do you want fries with that? Like, would you like an extra skill set with that? Would you like extra experience with that? And you bundle it all in. You can't do that anymore. So now you need to pare it all back. So get your job description out and work out what are the absolute musts and what do you really need. And then put a line through all the things that are just not necessary. Mm. And then you recruit from there. So for your environment, make sure you've got a really great environment that is supportive. I talk about these things called stay interviews. So often when people leave, we do an exit interview to capture what went wrong. You can still do an exit interview, but instead, if we, with the stay interviews, that means sitting down with somebody and talking to them about what's good about here. What do you like about your job? What do you like about your boss? What do you like about the environment? And it's very powerful to get people to actually articulate and say it out loud, the reasons that they like their job. So that can help you to sort of aid with retention for the roles.
Mm. Like, you don't really think about that, do you? As you say, there is that interview to get the job, and there is the exit interview. But that's a great idea, like, find out what it is that people like about working for you.
That's
right. And build on that.
Yeah, and the good thing with that is then you can also learn. Like, you might not have realised there was an aspect of the culture or the business that was really good that you weren't aware of. You might have just thought that was, like, you know, something that was just so little, but in actual fact it's really important to people.
And it can also be a place to kind of find out issues that might be bubbling under the surface that you're not aware of.
That's right. Well, I talk a little bit later about that in terms of human capital and making sure that we are looking after our human capital as much as we do every other piece of, you know, working capital in our environment. So yeah, definitely really important. Well-being. So in this environment, lots of people are sort of pulling back on some of the perks and benefits, which is normal. So what I will say to businesses that are doing that, please don't worry about that. It's not the glue that will keep people. It's more of sort of the glitter. It's the nice to have, but it actually won't be the thing that always keeps people. What will keep your employees in this environment is very much about well-being and making sure that you're looking after them. So if you're overloaded and your workload's more because of the skills shortage, I can guarantee your team are in the same situation. Mm. So when we talk about well-being, it's about that, making sure that you're monitoring workloads. If people are working extra, acknowledge, recognise it, see what you can do to remove some of that workload. That's my view on this whole well-being piece.
Yeah, so it's not about the ping pong tables and the free breakfast.
No, it's not a free lunch anymore.
It's totally about monitoring their mental health and making
completely
sure
that's exactly
people are
right.
coping.
And also that goes back to leadership, which I talk about at the end as well. People want leaders who care. So and this is the whole piece that's come out of COVID. So when we talk about what's bubbled to the surface, it's the importance that people are putting on their own well-being, and then the importance that they're putting on their leaders to make sure that that's also happening. So leaders who care are just paramount, and it has to be authentic, it has to be genuine.
Yeah, and they do say that the culture filters from the top down.
Totally, so. Yeah, exactly. Okay, so your hybrid workers. hybrid or remote, I'm going to put them in the same sort of bracketing here. We talk about proximity bias, which means that you and I are working together day to day, we sit at a desk, then my attention and focus is going to be on you, likely. But the workers that I've got, the staff, the employees that I have that are working remotely or in a hybrid situation, we sort of lose that sort of contact with that. They're the guys that are most likely to probably lose engagement, lose motivation, and for them to resign. They're the ones that are probably at risk. So you want to make sure that you've got something in place. And I'll jump to flexibility on this as well. So flexibility, everyone wants flexibility, but what ties in with this hybrid and remote piece is making sure that you've put the structures in place as well. So it's all well and good to allow the flexibility to work from home, but are you putting the right structures in place to enable your employees to be successful and to regain the level of engagement that they have in their job?
I've got a couple of questions that have come through. One is from Camille, and she's saying, recruiting with a good culture fit is great in theory, but really hard to do. What are your tips for making this work well in the interview process?
I'll try and answer that, Camille. I hope I've got the right answer for you. It's about asking the right questions and maybe defining what your culture is, and doing that through values. So maybe that is like a brainstorm with your team, or if you know what that is really well and you know what the deal breakers are for your culture, then take that with you when you go to the interview, and then you design the questions around that. And don't be afraid to ask some of those questions that are on point or a little bit difficult or whatever it might be, because that's going to flush to the surface the whole piece around culture. Culture is it's everything. That's the glue that keeps people there. And if you can define that, and maybe that's part of the issue, maybe the definition around the culture hasn't been defined or fleshed out enough. I hope that helped.
Yeah, and I've got another one from Sarah. It's kind of tying into that wellness and the incentives that used to go with that. She's saying, what are some low-cost suggestions to help retain staff since pay rises and incentives are out of reach for many small businesses right
now? Totally, yeah. So I always think it's about the recognition and acknowledgement. It might sound not what you're asking or about, but I sort of do believe that thanking people for doing a good job, acknowledging them in a group situation, calling people, if you're not in the office, just calling to check on people, those things go tenfold out. But in terms of benefits or perks or those sorts of things, it could be something as simple as a lunch. You know, takeaways brought in, Uber Eats brought in. It could be something about, again, putting a breakfast on or letting people leave early. If you recognise that they've done a really good job, maybe give them a half day off. The flexibility to work from home also allows people to save money. It can be any of those sorts of things. You know, it could be team yoga. And there's even lots of meditation and things like that that are actually free that you can do that might also show that element of well-being. What I would caution people to do though is don't be thinking about the perks and benefits from a superficial level. Do it if you believe that will actually help your employees and not just throw a whole lot of perks and benefits. I think that's what we did last year when everyone was sort of scrambling to work out how can I do things better, how can I retain, how can I attract people. And what we focused on were all these perks, and what we probably needed to do was get back to the basics of what is it that people really want. So I hope that helps.
I really like that idea of gratitude and you know, thanking your employees for doing a good job, because oftentimes that slides by because everyone's just on this wheel of having to get more work done or the next project or whatever. Like taking some time to reflect and say, great job guys, it is really important.
Well, and interesting, that piece on gratitude is understanding that when people are working the additional hours, if that's what they're doing, that's probably having an impact somewhere else in their lives. So maybe asking the questions around that, you know, how is your family, understanding who in their family, it could be a partner, it could be anything like that. But I think if you have an interest and be asking questions like that, I really believe that that goes so much further than yoga.
Definitely. Before we move on, I've got another question that was in regards to job descriptions. And it's from Adam, and he says, I think a lot of job descriptions make people feel like I only meet 7 out of the 10 criteria, so I won't apply. Is there a way to appeal to prospective talent who may be put off by really detailed job descriptions?
Yeah, that's a really good question. We actually see that happen all the time. So the first thing is do not put a job description on your ad. So your advertisement should really be about attracting people. So putting everything in your advert that is all the great things about the role. You should be keeping it as open as possible, because to attract the right people, you can't narrow it down. It needs to be really open, because you might meet someone that doesn't actually fit the whole brief but can do the job. And that's how we recruit, and we've always recruited like that even before the skills shortage, about identifying talent and looking for people that way. But then when you come back actually to the job description, at some stage, and not all organisations actually have job descriptions, I might just say, and at some stage that job description probably will need to be shared if it is part of, you know, the way your process and the way that you do things. But maybe if you're mindful of that, because lots of businesses will put the kitchen sink in there to cover all, and I just don't think to do that. I often will say to people when I give them a job description that is a cover all, I'll often say, please look at the job description. It's got everything in there. It's a guideline. But talk to me about areas that might be of concern, because that's a really good point that Adam's made. It does sometimes put people off. So yeah. I encourage businesses not to do that with job description. Every piece of your recruitment needs to be fine-tuned and be thinking about the bigger picture.
Yeah, and there's transferable skills, obviously, as well. Like, people don't have to tick every single box. They might work in a different field completely, but have a transferable skill that could make them great for the job.
Totally. That's exactly what we look for now. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, skills audit. So this is something that I would encourage you also to do. So I love talking about this piece, because what often happens is we recruit someone, then we put them in an office and we leave them to it. And then what happens is we sort of check on them every now and then, but we forget their background. So we forget some of the skills they had. We forget the degrees that they might hold. So you might have someone sitting in accounts who's brilliant at their job, but actually might have really amazing writing skills. So you've probably got people in your business that can do different parts of jobs that are coming through now. And also that will add, obviously, to retention, because people are further engaged. So I would encourage you, maybe do this when you do your stay interviews, is to do a skills audit at the same time. Pull out someone's resume, spend some time with them, understand what skills they've had previously, where they've worked, different industries, for example, and also what are their aspirations and their dreams. Because if you can help to fulfill that, then that will also help you with that retention piece. In actual fact, if you've got mobility, a learning environment that has job mobility within your business, and again, small businesses can do that. We do this as all the time, in fact, and we've got people who've progressed through, you are likely to keep that person for somewhere between five point four years by having a learning environment that enables people to move in their jobs. Workplace flex, we've talked about. Human capital, I've touched on, which is about looking after your human capital, that's us, as much as you do with your machinery or your cars or your photocopiers. For all of those, we'll do insurances, we'll do checks right on time, because otherwise it will negate the guarantee, the warranties, etc. But we sometimes don't do that with our human capital. So if you think about those catch-ups that you booked, performance review that was booked, and then you delay it by a week, that does have an effect on people. So I just really encourage you to treat your human capital even more than we do with any other piece of...
So you mean effect on their morale?
Yeah. So for us, if we're used to delivering performance reviews and we've got other things that crop up, we're like, oh, I can move that till next week. That poor person has probably been sweating on that performance review ever since you booked it in. And they've been prepping for it. And maybe the night before they didn't sleep well about it. So, you know, be mindful of the impact you have when you move those sorts of things around. Yeah. And be mindful of the fact when you keep those on time every time, of the message that you're sending back to the people that you work with, that they're important to you. Okay, resignations. I love this piece here, because often I've coached employees about how to resign the right way. So, you know, making sure that you exit correctly so that you leave on a high. Your boss is going to say good things about you, your colleagues are going to say good things about you. Most importantly, you leave feeling really great, but you can come back. Equally, for employers, it doesn't matter how disappointed you are, how upset you might be, try and put that emotional piece aside and make sure that whoever is exiting exits on the right way, on a high, feel good, give them a lunch, whatever it might be, so that they leave there saying great things about your business and about the culture and the environment. Now, obviously they're leaving for a reason, but it doesn't matter. You want them to leave on that day feeling really great. It then allows you the possibility to have people back. So what's really interesting is last year in 2022 with the whole great resignation, we had a survey went out and it was something like 40% of people who left their jobs regretted leaving their jobs and said that their roles were better in their previous position. 20% of those people then went back to their old roles.
Oh, wow.
So we call that the whole boomerang employee.
Yeah.
So there's really powerful reasons for you to make sure that resignation is great.
So don't have a hissy fit.
Totally.
Don't like never. Throw the toys in the corner.
At all. Don't make it difficult for people. Make it really nice for people. Yeah. Leadership. So leadership is all about managers and leaders. So I think that's evidence.
Yeah.
Okay, so my tips. I want to talk to you about compromise, alumni, networks, and then I want to talk to you about untapped talent pools, because if you just think that you're going to go back to recruiting and tapping into a workforce that is unemployed at the moment, then you know I think we've established that that's just not going to work. So compromise. And we've touched on this with the job description already, but revisiting what your skills are that you need in your business and what it is. So everything has to be compromised now. You cannot recruit the person that you recruited 10 years ago or even 5 years ago. So be thinking about what are the transferable skills and what is it that you can upskill and reskill, and is there anyone in your business that can do that now?
Yeah, so don't just hold out, keep holding endless interviews looking for that one perfect person. Mm-mm. Look at the people that are like a good fit, have most of the skills.
Completely.
That will be a cultural fit for the business and, yeah, you know, can learn on the job.
That's right. So you're right, there is no perfect candidate out there anymore. It has to be someone, and if you core it right back to what is critical for us, and what is probably going to be critical is the transferable skills and the attributes that suit your environment. Mm-hmm. And again, don't forget, if they're taking more than one step up, two or three steps up, make sure your environment matches that, but also that they're carrying the attributes that will help them to excel in that role.
Well, questions. Paris is asking, what do you think about proactive recruitment?
I'm assuming Paris means if you identify someone and you don't need them in the moment, hire them anyway. If that's what you mean, Paris, then I'm all for that. Now, some businesses might have tight budgets and not allow that. But if I can just explain what I mean. Because of what we've all experienced, I think everyone's been sort of hurt by the feeling of having that empty seat vacant for so long. So if you do see talent, I would encourage you to sort of explore where that might fit for your business and the value that you might be able to have. So when we talk about flexible working, and I'm sorry if I didn't mention that a little bit earlier, when we talk about flexible working, it's not just about your employees, hybrid, remote, leave early, etc. It's also about the way that we're thinking about the new place and the new ways of working now. So we need to have a flexible mindset. So if you do meet somebody, and you do think they could be value for your business, then I would absolutely encourage that to happen, because the value that they can add could outstrip any cost on salary that you might have.
What if you don't have the budget? Just keep the conversation going with them, you know.
Keep the conversation going, revisit, have ongoing coffees for the future, keep them in your diary to do that. That's exactly what I would do, And also in this market, I never used to encourage this before, but I have absolutely for the last couple of years. You can design the job around the person.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have said that previously because it's dangerous when that person leaves, but in this environment, do look to design the job around the person.
And a few more questions. Ritika, I think that's how you pronounce your name, is saying, finding staff with the right skills can be harder for businesses in regional and rural areas. Yeah. So any tips to share? Is it all about upskilling the people that you have?
Yeah, everything is about upskilling, whether you're regional or in the cities. What I love about regional, and I'm originally from country Victoria, so I go back and visit often, and maybe, and I do this anyway, but I most certainly do it in the country areas. When I see someone that is good, I will leave them my card. Pretty much every time I go to the country, if I go on holidays or anything like that, I'll be like, I thought you were amazing, Cec. You did that coffee really well. Here's my card. If you're ever thinking about coming to Sydney, please let me know.
Oh, thank you.
Or it could be in anything like that. So if you're in a regional area and you need to recruit someone, don't just be thinking about the office that you're in or whatever it might be. You might see someone who's pretty amazing in the petrol station, in the cafe, in wherever it might be, news agency. And if you believe that they've sort of got the transferable skills to help you, invite them to have a coffee.
Yeah.
And recruit from the city as well. Don't be afraid to place advertisements where people from the city are going to see your ad and come to the country. Don't forget we had that whole exodus of people leaving the city to come to regional areas. There's a lot to be said for regional.
I do have one more question. Yeah. Are platforms like Seek and Indeed still a good place to find staff? Or are LinkedIn, freelancer marketplaces a better option these days?
All of them. We use all of them, and I would use all of them. The thing with Seek and Indeed and any of those sorts of platforms, they will be for people who are actively job seeking. So if you do advertise on there and you see an application come through, you need to jump on that straight away. So don't be waiting 3 days. If you wait 3 days, they've already had 5 interviews. Think about it, these are active job seekers. So they're in a role at the moment and they've decided they want to leave. And I can tell you recruiters, us, as soon as they hit our inbox, we're on them. So if you want to compete with everybody else for those job seekers, then you need to action it straight away. Don't be thinking that you can let it go. And LinkedIn is fantastic to be reaching out to people as well. So I would use every platform. Don't just silo it.
Yeah, and it's a talent marketplace still, isn't it?
That's right. Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. So where was I up to? I think it was alumni, I'm not sure. So alumni is basically who's left and who would you like back? So again, think about those boomerang employees. Networks, so who do your employees know that you could reach out to? And be thinking about this, the cost of your empty seat, so the cost of an empty seat is prolonged now. The cost to use a recruiter, and then the whole impact on your environment, so the extra workload that's been shared out, that's having an impact on all of your colleagues, including yourself. So if you think about what that whole cost is, maybe you might want to put an incentive in place for people to refer people to you. So untapped talent pools. Okay, I love this part of it. So we're going to talk about older workers, mid-career candidates, so that's people who are 55 years and above, grads and return to work mums. So first of all, for untapped talent pools, I want you to think about moving away from stereotypes and biases. That's the piece when we talk about compromising that you need to sort of abolish. If you can, we all have them. You can't move away from them totally. And they're a learnt way of thinking. So question, and again, when I said about flexibility at work, this is also about our minds now. So being really flexible and open when you're thinking about people. So older workers, some stats to share with you. Life expectancy now sits at 83. It used to be 71 in 1970, so you can see that it's all gradually shifting. The average retirement age in 2004 was 62 years, and that 14, 15, 65, so again, increasing. And almost a quarter of us are not intending to retire until the age of 70 or older. So if you think about that, if an older worker is interestingly, last year the ABS used to define an older worker as 43 years and above, but I believe it's all shifted now. So when I'm talking about older workers in this category, I'm talking about those people who are probably in that retirement pool age, so anywhere from 60 to 65 and beyond. So I'd be thinking about those workers for you. And it might mean that they don't want to work full time, it might be 3 days, 4 days. 55, so lots of people think that mid-career is 35. It's actually 55, it used to be 35. Our 55-year-olds represent 19.4% of our workforce that is over 55 years. And they also represent 38.5% of our population above the ages of 19. So that's a significant group of people. So with workforce tenure extending, that minimum age bracket has now aligned to that 50. And for the first time in our history, we've got these five generations working together. Gen X sits right in the middle. So be thinking again about anyone that's in their mid-50s and beyond in terms of hiring.
So how does that work then for culture fit? Because obviously people of different generations may have different values.
I think it's amazing for cultural fit, especially for diversity. And I talk about something, I wonder if it's on the next, even if it's on the next tab, I can talk about it now. This piece called buddyship. So I've been speaking about this for a fair while now. It's different to mentoring. So if you take the youngest person that's in your organization, it might be someone who's 20, even younger. And then you take the oldest person, and hopefully that's someone who's 70, likely not, but if it was, it would be amazing. Maybe it's someone who's 58. And then you, the whole idea is that they're sharing their knowledge. So if you think about the 18-year-old teaching the 58, 70-year-old TikTok, social media, how to do it really well, and then the older person in your workforce is teaching this person about how to write an agenda, how to do a presentation, business etiquette, how to write a proper email, all of those things that we take for granted, but in actual fact could help that person. And that in itself breaks down barriers, will help with retention, it increases engagement, and everything else that goes with it. You will need to have a proper program that goes with it, but it's actually informal. So this is not a, that person's more senior than me, it's nothing about that. It's about a really informal way of that younger person and the older person being able to connect and go to each other for advice. Mm. Imagine having your 7-year-old being totally au fait on TikTok and social media and running your social profile. I mean, I think that would be amazing.
I love it.
Okay, so the elephant in the room, and I have to bring this up. So if anyone has been cautious about hiring older workers, and what I mean by that is now anyone who's 55 and above, you're not alone. But I want to try and break a little bit of this myth. So there's scientific evidence, and by the way, all of these stats that I've got, if anyone would like the source of them, please reach out and I can share that with you. So the scientific evidence that shows for most people, raw mental horsepower declines after the age of 30, but knowledge, expertise, the main predictors of job performance, even increase even beyond the age of 80. So let's rethink how we see older workers, please. Grads, okay, so the youth unemployment rate sits at 7.8%, so put that against the 3.5 of our general population. And graduates, it varies between 15 to 27% are unemployed or not using their degree. So I think we've got a lot to offer there for our grads and youth. And again, this is where I was talking about the buddyships, that you can marry that up. I think it is a really great thing to think about. Working mums. So Australia, interestingly, and I was pretty shocked when I realised this, Australia sits at the bottom half of OECD countries for employment rates for working mums. Interestingly, Iceland sits at the top for having the best employment rates for youth, disabled, older workers, immigrants, and return to work mums.
How much of that is to do with their policies, though? Like Iceland is very forward with their policies towards assisting women back into the workforce. And, you know, diversity and inclusion is something that was part of their...
And this is the thing, because they've always been about that, that's why they're in that situation. So I do think that we need to revisit how we think about our workforce, how we think about people that we work with and everything to do with that, because then that will break down some of those barriers and some of the biases that go with that. In our environment, so we have 12 employees, nearly half of them are working mums, and all of those working mums do reduced hours, split days. Two of them are based in the UK, fully remote. Yeah. So, and we've been doing that so probably for about 8 years. One in particular who's working in the UK. So I always think about these situations in the workforce or anything to do with business is what is the ultimate goal? What's the result you want? And then think about the processes that get you there. Any of the processes that are broken, that cause delays or anything like that, get rid of them and just change your mind, the way that you're thinking about things to make it work for you. So there's 7 million mums in Australia. That's a lot of talent that we can be tapping into. And over the past 20 years, this is a really interesting fact, 46% increase in women operating businesses, with mothers making up 81% of those women operators. If you think about what it takes to run your own business, so innovation, enterprise thinking, resilience, adaptability, hard work. So what have we been missing out on by not reaching out to mums, return to work mums, etc.? And they've done this because they were forced into that situation as well. So please, let's think about that. there is something, if we touch on at the end, there is something else to think about in terms of bias when we talk about this whole piece around, I think it's like mumnesia or baby brain that sometimes is also, you know, put with mums. It's actually, and again, it's been proven that the brain develops as your child is developing, and it's that whole piece around empathy and care. And if that is one of the core skills that we cry out for our leaders, I often think, well, what have we missed out on by labeling it as, you know, mumnesia or whatever it might be? It's actually a really important skill set that is developing that we probably can tap into better.
So can I ask, how can we, if we're recruiting, how can we prevent bias? You know, like, it's so easy to fall back into your unconscious bias.
I don't know that you can prevent it, but what I do think you can do is be aware. So maybe if you're aware of it in the first place, know that you, I mean, I carry bias when I go into interviews, but I also try and question my assumptions when I'm thinking no. So if your automatic reflex is no, maybe ask why. Why am I thinking that? Oh, because of my experience I had 3 years ago with somebody who had a similar profile. Okay, so you need to bin that and rethink again. Yeah. Okay, your recruitment process. So you can see here I've put the roadrunner because everything has to be about speed. Same as what I mentioned about if you've got applications coming through, you need to action them straight away. So are there any hiring managers here or anyone that's recruiting? You need to make sure that your vacancy is approved first because there's nothing worse going through that whole piece and then the MD or the CEO hasn't rubber stamped it and there's a delay. You will lose that candidate. So please make sure that you've got the vacancy approved first. Line up all of your processes. So from the get-go, think of this as a project plan. The end result being that you want an offer and someone to start. So if you think about when you want someone to start and then work backwards from that. So again, is the vacancy approved? Do you have a contract that's ready that all you need to do is put in the figures and the address and the person's details? When will the onboarding be? Who's going to be involved in the interview process and are they actually available to interview? So there's no point starting and then the people that need to be involved in the interview are overseas. So be thinking about all of that. Processes need to be lined up. Consider working with a recruiter. If you do, pick one recruiter. Lots of companies will still do multi-listing. That's way antiquated. Any good recruiter will not do multi-listing. And pick the recruiter that will do a great job for you. And do put them through the mill in terms of questions so that you feel really comfortable with who you've chosen. You want them to be 100% accountable. Think about who's interviewing and why. So sometimes in smaller businesses, what we do is we include the world in the interview process because we want everyone to feel like they've got a say. I'm not sure that always works, and I would suggest asking yourself again, this is like an assumption base, why am I including that person and what's the value? Does it add value? Is it important? If it's not needed, get away with it. Do away with it, rather, and don't do that. Do interview within 2 days of identifying talent, and your recruiter will help you with this. Equally, if you've got an internal recruiter or HR and they've flagged someone for you, please do make it a priority and do everything you can to see that person. And I'll give you a scenario. If you wait longer than, say, 4 days, 5 days, there's a very good chance that that person has got another 4 or 5 interviews happening. So you do want to have everything moving really, really quickly. Plus, it's this whole psychological engagement as well. If someone has spoken to them about your job and they've got them peaked with enthusiasm, you want to capture and use that momentum. If you leave it for a period of time, someone else has already slipped in there with their own excitement and everything about another job.
I can't believe it, but we're almost out of time. I've got a question here from Mitch, and he's saying, in a strictly client-facing and collaborative business environment, how do you best manage the desire for work from home and flexibility? We are all for flexibility, but cannot be to the detriment of the client.
Yet totally.
Employee perception has drastically changed. It makes it hard to both win and retain staff.
Yeah, good question. So my take on that is you have to do what's best for the business. This is part of what the issue was last year, is that we bent over backwards to do everything we possibly could to make sure that all of our employees were looked after and that we were as flexible as possible. The issue with that is some businesses made that call and it was at the detriment to the business. I'm sorry, but I think that you have to stand firm, and if it doesn't work for your business, then maybe you can't offer it. Except what you can do is offer parts of it. Maybe it might be one day from home. Maybe it might be a day that everybody does it from home, or it's a leave early, leave late, come in later. Find out why. I think find out why first, because then if you know the why, you can go back to working out the rest out.
Yeah, I've got one sneaky question, which is I'm just wondering about staff churn, because some businesses seem to be impacted by churn a lot, whereas others can retain their employees for years and years and years. What do you think is the biggest element affecting staff churn?
So I think every business actually has churn at some stage. It usually is just selecting the wrong person at the wrong time, the wrong fit, in conjunction with the environment, in conjunction with you know, whoever's looking after them, managing them, not having enough time, etc. Sometimes churn is good. You know, I have to say, sometimes resignations are not a bad thing. What we've all experienced, though, hasn't necessarily been a great thing in the last year. And the real issue when you do have churn is how long it takes you to backfill that role.
I'm afraid that's all we've got time for today. Like, thanks so much for joining us. And thank you, Roxanne, for all
of your
fantastic insights. Now, if you want to find out more great advice or tips about the skill shortage or any other issue facing small businesses, head to our website, koshisbusinessbuilders.com.au. And if you'd like to learn more about Roxanne or the services that she provides, visit www.est10.com.au. That's EST10.com.au. Join us again next month for our next masterclass, A Small Business Guide to TikTok. Thanks again for joining me. See you.